So yes, I'm Kajsa Kanebratt, and I will present today to you about the 3D cultures of liver cells that we use within drug discovery and development. So the outline of my talk will be to give some brief introduction and background. Then I will talk about drug metabolism in 3D liver cultures. I will touch upon 3D liver cultures as an in vitro NAFLD model. And then to talk about 3D livers, how we use them in microphysiological systems, and a little bit looking forward to the future. So as said, I work in AstraZeneca, a pharma company. And when in drug discovery and development, we have the dilemma of attrition of our drug candidates during all phases of development. And in this picture, the graph here from 2014, you can see that a lot of the attrition was due to safety or efficacy. But in the late 90s, we also had a lot of attrition due to PK/PD properties. So this triggers us to try to develop and use more relevant preclinical models that can capture these properties of our drug candidates. And these models should preferably mimic both healthy and diseased humans. So if we go to the in vitro liver models, why do we need that? Well, the liver is the most important drug metabolizing organ, but it's also important in diseases. And for this, we need to have predictive in vitro methods. I work in a team where we investigate the ADME properties of our drug candidates. That is the absorption, distribution, metabolism, and elimination. And this we normally do in suspension of primary human hepatocytes. And PHH, if you see the abbreviation, it's primary human hepatocytes. These hepatocytes, if we have them in suspension, they can only be used for short-term experiments, about 4 hours. We can also, of course, then plate them in 2D cultures, but we know that they de-differentiate quickly in this setting. What is also of importance is the assays that we use today are optimized for their respective readouts. But here we see the possibility that the 3D liver cultures, which we also call spheroids, could be an in vitro model that could deliver multiple ADME readouts from a single test system under the same experimental conditions. So, when we build our in vitro models, we always have to weigh the throughput against the physiological relevance of the model. And as I said, suspension of cells, they can be quite high throughput, but have a lower physiological relevance. On the other hand of the scale, we have the MPS system, the microphysiological systems. And close to them, we have the 3D liver spheroids. And these spheroids, they can be both mono or co-cultures of different cell types. And here we have the so important cell-cell interaction, which is so important for the functionality of the hepatocytes. And we also have the cell matrix interaction. And this makes this model suitable for long-term cellular response, and also for disease modeling. So during the last years, there has been several publications about 3D spheroids, liver spheroids. And one of the first papers was from Catherine Bell at Karolinska Institute at that time in 2016. And they showed that these 3D liver cultures are more like the livers they come from than they are like each other. So they capture the inter-individual variability in humans. And they are also more like the livers than the 2D cultures. So I think this paper has triggered a lot of work on hepatic spheroids. After that, we have seen several publications on using this model for tox and also as a disease model. But so far, there has not been published so much about drug metabolism in this system, and that is what we are interested in. So, yes. For those of you that are not that familiar with drug metabolism and pharma development, I just want to explain a little bit about the assays that we typically have in hepatocytes. So one of the most important assays is the clearance or clearance intrinsic assay. Here we measure the disappearance of compound from the cell incubation, and this is then scaled to disappear to the clearance from the blood. We also look at metabolite identification. That is where we look what is formed from our drug candidates when they are metabolized. So we need to ensure that there are no toxic metabolized form and that the metabolites are covered in animal studies. We can also look at active transport in and out of the hepatocyte. This is used to predict the clearance also, and also for looking for drug-drug interactions. Another feature we need to determine for our drug candidates is if they induce or inhibit enzymes and transporters. Then we have an assay that we call cytochrome P450 activity. This is not used to characterize our drug compounds, but to characterize the in vitro systems. So the aim of our study was to show how 3D liver spheroids can be used to measure metabolic endpoints, but hopefully also in the future to be combined with other ADME properties and also pharmacological readouts. So the data I will focus on today is from the clearance and metabolite identification. This is a brief overview of how we run our experiments. So we seed 2,000 hepatocytes into one well of an ultra-low attachment plate. And you see in the pictures below here how it looks on day zero, which is the seeding day. Then by time, the hepatocytes self-aggregate because when they can't attach to the plastic, they want to attach to each other instead. So just by that, they form these nice round spheroids. It takes about 5 to 7 days, depending on the batch of hepatocytes. And on day seven, we start using them for our experiments. And in this setting, we have measured P450 activity and ATP as viability measurement at several time points. But the clearance and metabolite identification experiments were started on day 11. And these experiments, they are run in a pool of 3 spheroids. To these spheroids, we add the drug compound and incubate over 72 hours. And we analyze the medium for substrate depletion. And this is the substrate depletion curves of the 6 compounds we have studied so far. So to the right and in the middle, you have compounds with medium to high clearance. And here you can see that we have quite a lot of data. We have tested this at several different test occasions and in 3 different batches of hepatocytes. For the compounds to the right, it's low clearance compound. And as you see, we have scarce data here. And that is because it's more difficult to determine these depletion curves when they hardly differ from zero depletion. But this is a well-known fact also for other in vitro systems. So from these depletion curves, we calculate the in vitro clearance intrinsic. And we don't have to go into all the numbers, but I can just say that these numbers are comparable to published data from other in vitro systems. But what we do next is that we, from the in vitro clint, we predict an in vivo clint. And that we then compare with the observed in vivo clint. So here on the x-axis, you have the observed, and on the y-axis, you have the predicted. And as you can see here, for four out of our six compounds, we have a good prediction within threefold for these compounds. The compounds that don't fall into this is the ones to the right, which is the high clearance compounds. And here we underpredict the clint. It's also seen in other in vitro systems, it's published in the literature, that we often see a tendency to underpredict the high clearance compound. What also can be mentioned is that these two compounds is actually metabolized by polymorphic enzymes, which could perhaps affect the results. It's not so many compounds, but we think this is a good start for the model to be used in our drug projects. What we do more is that from the same incubations that we measure this clint, we also take the medium and the spheroids, and we look at the metabolic profiles. So in this example, we have sildenafil. You have the parent compound here in the middle. And then we look at which metabolites are formed. And it is the five entities we see here. We then, of course, compare it to how does it look in vivo. And in this scheme to the right, the metabolites marked with blue are the major human metabolites, and they match the ones that we get from the 3D liver cultures. The ones that are not marked, it's actually metabolized from animal species. So we cover the human metabolites in our system, which is a positive thing, of course. If you look at metabolite formation of all our six compounds, I know that this figure can be perhaps a bit overwhelming. But what we do is that we, based on the MS peak area, the mass spectrometry peak area, we calculate the relative percent of the parent and of the different metabolites we can detect. So if we take, for example, carvedilol here, we see a lot of metabolites formed, and we see both primary and secondary metabolites. So we see sequential metabolism in this system. Here we have hydroxylation plus glucuronidation. We also see direct glucuronidation of this compound. And this sequential metabolism is something very advantageous from this model, because this is difficult to capture in the 2D or in the suspension short-term experiment. We need to be able to incubate a little bit longer to see this. You can also here see that we have a bit different levels of the parent remaining, and also of the different metabolites. This is true for all compounds, but this is also a reflection of the different donors and the intra-individual variability. And this is also something good to be able to capture this in vivo feature in also in vitro. And for the more low clint compounds, we don't see that many metabolites, which is also reflected in parent, the amount parent remaining. But that fits also well with the clint values. And for all of our tested compounds, the spheroids reproduce the major metabolites observed in man. So a short summary of this part is that we have a spheroid system that can reproducibly demonstrate sustained activity of P450s and UDTs over time. We can measure low clint with three spheroids. We have tested with one spheroid also. I didn't show any results of that here today. But this also gives, this model also gives us a flexibility in how we do our incubations. Because if you have a 2D setting, you need to plate a specific number of cells to cover the plate. But here we can pool three spheroids, or we can perhaps pool 10 spheroids if we have want to have higher turnover in our system. So this flexibility is also an advantage. And we see clearance predicted within threefold for 4 out of 6 compounds. And as I said, the metabolites form, both primary and secondary, matches the major metabolites in man. What we are working on here now is to extend the evaluation of the compounds with more compounds, with more low clint compounds, because that is where drug discovery is going today. We are looking for compounds with low clearance, but also we want to evaluate compounds with non-P450 metabolism. What we are also interested in looking at is the ADME properties of steatotic spheroids. And that brings us into the next part of the talk, which is the use of 3D liver cultures as an in vitro NAFLD model. NAFLD, or non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, it's recognized as the most common chronic liver disease nowadays, and they have a prevalence about 25 to 30% globally. We don't have to go into too many details about the disease, but what is important is that some of the individuals with NAFLD also progress into NASH, the steatohepatitis, and that who progress or not is greatly affected by human genetics. We have two important mutations, the PNPLA3 and the TM6SF2, that has an effect on who becomes a NASH patient or not. So our question was if these genetic differences we see in vivo, can they also be captured in vitro? So we have formed spheroids from hepatocytes from wild-type donors, but also from a donor with the TM6SF2 mutation. And what we have done with these spheroids is that we have treated them with different concentration of fatty acids. And we have done that over a period of 10 days. We then look at the relative increase in lipid content. So this is compared to control, untreated control. And we see for this wild type that we have about 6-fold increase of the lipid content at day 10. Here is data from 2 more wild type donors, where the increase is not that pronounced. And in this wild type 3, we don't see much of increase and no dose response. But that is also a variability between individuals. But what about the mutant then? Here you have the TM6SF2 mutant spheroids. And you see a dramatic increase in the lipid content in this donor. At day 10, we have about 15-fold increase with the highest fatty acid concentration. And this indicates that this spheroid model can capture these genetic differences, and this model can be used to study this disease or disorder in vitro. This is just some, at least I think, some beautiful pictures of the spheroids, where we also see this difference. Here to the lower right, you have the mutant with a high fatty acid treatment, and you see a lot more lipid droplets and bigger lipid droplets if you compare to the wild type here. And what we're doing here is to include other liver cell types, like the Kupffer cells and the stellate cells. And that is in the end to be able to induce inflammation and fibrosis and create a NASH model for the liver spheroids. Now I want to turn over to the use of 3D livers in microphysiological systems. And here we have a collaboration with Tissues, an MPS company in Berlin. And this is their four organ chip in our laboratory. And you might wonder why we want to go into these complex models. Well, we work with cardiometabolic diseases, and that's a complex disease system where many organs are affected. We have the liver, we have the pancreas, and we have adipose and muscle. And if we then have the cardiac part, we also have the heart that is connected to this. So our question from the beginning is if there is a benefit to co-culture organs in a fluidic system instead of having them separate in a static system. And we started out a couple of years ago with a two organ system where we had liver represented by HEPA-RD cells and connected to pancreatic islets. We went from the HEPA-RD cells to the primary human hepatocytes. And now we have also added a third organ with the cardiac microtissue. I just want to show you how the liver function looks in these three organ chip cultures. So if we look at the albumin production, which is important for the hepatocytes, we see that we have retained albumin production in the three organ chip, whereas in the single organ static, we always have no or almost no albumin production, both in our MPS healthy medium and in the liver maintenance medium. And it's also in the urea production, we see stable urea production over time. And also in the chip organ setting, we can trigger the disease phenotype with treating the system with a media with high glucose and also with fatty acids. And we're seeing increase in lipid content here. So this is also something that we are building for the disease area and for the future. Just a little looking forward to what do we need in the industry to make full potential of these 3D liver cultures. And as you can imagine from the picture here, is automation, because it's quite labor intensive to work with the 3D cultures. So we have started with this, and we at the moment we have two systems. We have one more simple system where we have we can do seed the spheroids, we can do media change and treatment, but we manually have to put the plates into the robot. Okay. Yeah, I don't have much more to but okay, should I? Yeah. Okay. So do you see the slides now? Yeah, good. I just want to briefly mention then that we have ongoing, almost finalized and fully automated system for handling everything with the spheroids. And we are also have a collaboration with KTH and Karolinska on forming mini liver, mini spheroids from just 100 cells instead of 2000, which could be put more into an HTS perspective. And then I just wanted to mention our what we are also so using the livers for liver organ 3D liver cultures for, and that is to bioprint, and we are trying to bioprint vascularized liver organoids, and this is a collaboration with CELLINK. And then finally, I was just want to acknowledge and thank everyone involved in the work I presented, all my AstraZeneca colleagues, a lot of works, a lot of people. Sebastian Prill was responsible for the NAFLD model. He was a postdoc at the time, and his academic supervisor, Professor Stefano Romeo. And at CELLINK, special thanks to Itterdal and Josephine. And at Tissue, a special thanks to our primary contact, Sophie Bauer. And this is our little heart-shaped liver spheroid. We are very fond of the liver spheroids. I think it's a model with great potential for us in drug discovery and development. And thank you for the attention.